Good morning. My name is Daniel. I'm an elder here within the walls of East Shore Baptist Church, and to start the day off, I just want to ask you one question, and the question is simply this: when you find yourself in a rut, when you find yourself in a funk, where do you go? How do you pull yourself out of it? Who do you confide in? Who do you talk to? Where do you go? Within the walls of my home, one of the things that we like to do is we like to watch Christian comedy. There is such a thing. We like to surround ourselves with good, sound, biblical friends. About music, if you're around me very much, you'll know that I happen to love music. There was a time when I was in the construction, and we were remodeling, a Catholic church, and they were throwing out the choir speakers, which stand about 4 foot tall. And so I put them in my very small garage. You will not be able to go higher than number 4, even though it goes to 10, on my stereo system within my garage. My wife asked me several times, are you having a concert out there? Because I just happen to love really good, like the song we just sang. Oh my, I can surround myself in really good music and get myself into a better, much better place. How about your favorite passage of Scripture? What is your favorite passage of Scripture? Does that help you? Does that pull you out? What lifts you up? What lifts you up? So today we are going to be in Exodus chapter 17, and we're going to be going from verse 1 through 7. Now, as tradition here in this church, when we read scriptures, I would like everybody, if you're able to stand as we read Exodus 17, 1 through 7, and we will begin the message. Exodus 17, 1 through 7. All the congregation of the people of Israel moved on from the wilderness of Sin by stages, according to the commandment of the Lord, and camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink. Therefore, the people quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." And Moses said to them, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you test the Lord?" But the people thirsted there for water, and the people grumbled against Moses and said, "Why did you bring us up out of Egypt to kill us and our children and our livestock with thirst?" So Moses cried to the Lord, "What shall I do with these people? They are almost ready to stone me." And the Lord said to Moses, "Pass on before the people, taking with you some of the elders of Israel, and take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile, and go. Behold, I will stand before you there on the rock at Horeb, and you shall strike the rock, and water shall come out of it, and the people will drink." And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. And he called the name of the place Massah and Meribah, because of the quarreling of the people of Israel, and because they tested the Lord by saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" You may be seated. Before I begin, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for your word. I thank you for the truth that is found in your word. Lord, I thank you for this opportunity that you've given me, Lord, to speak your word, your truth. Lord, I pray that you bring your Spirit, your Holy Spirit, to open the ears and open the minds and the hearts of the people that are going to hear this message, those that are here and will hear it later on, Lord. Lord, may, as Pastor John so well says it, may I decrease, seriously. May I get very small and you get very big. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Verse 1, all the congregation of the people of Israel moved on from the wilderness of Sin by stages, according to the commandment of the Lord, and camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink. What I see in that passage is it is entirely possible for you and I to be doing, no kidding, 100% of what God has called us to do, and there's a problem. You can see in that passage of Scripture, it says, according to the commandment of the Lord, they're going through a wilderness. So God is clearly telling them, you're going through the wilderness. So it's possible that we're doing something that God has, no kidding, called us to do, and there's an issue. I think of raising a family. It's not an easy thing to do. It's an incredibly rewarding thing to do, but it's definitely not an easy thing to do. Our former pastor, Tom, used to say this, ministry is messy. Ministry is messy, and it is, because we're trying to help people along. We're doing what God has called us to do. We're trying to help people along, but not 100% of the people want to hear 100% of what he has to say. How about your place of employment? You could be, as a man, we are called to be the financial person in our home. We're also called to be the spiritual leader in our home. It's not an easy thing to do. It's what God has called us to do. It's not an easy thing to do. So, in all this to say, speed bumps happen. Speed bumps happen when we are in God's will. It's what we do with those speed bumps that greatly affect our day. There's one of my number one passages of Scripture that I go to when these things happen, and it's just to reaffirm to me that life is normal. Life here is normal. It's John 16:33. This is one that, in my mind, that you should highlight and you should underline, put asterisks by in your Bible, because you're going to refer to this Scripture. You could refer to this Scripture moment by moment in your life. This is the words of Jesus. So these are the words in red. And this is right before he heads to the cross. And I found in studying people's lives, they often say the most profound things right before they pass away, right before they know that they're moving on. So Jesus is going to the cross. He knows this. And he's talking to his disciples. And he says this to his disciples. I have said these things to you that in me you may have peace. Sounds great so far. But in here in the middle of this passage of Scripture, it says, in the world you will have tribulation. Oh, that's terrible. I don't want tribulation. Oh, but, take heart. I have overcome the world. Again, one of the passages that you should see the gospel lived out in this, just in this passage of Scripture. See, because before that problem came to you, he has it. He's not denying that you're going to have problems. Matter of fact, he's telling you you're going to have problems. But take heart, I have overcome whatever's coming your way. Before your problem came, he knew about it. Your problem is real. Okay, he knows that, but take heart, I've overcome the world. One of the things that in my working time, if you will, in my career, I was in the military, and anyway, I had a lot of commanders. So I was in for 32 years. All this to say is that about every 3 years, I get a new commander. And some of those commanders were really good at selling ice to Eskimos, if you know what I mean. They would sell you down the road, in other words, tell you something that was not true, making them look better. I appreciated a commander that told me, where you're going is not easy, the job that you're going to do is not easy, but you can do it. And that's Jesus, that's what Jesus is saying here. He said, I've said these things to you, okay, so I want you to have my peace as you head into this problem, but the problem is real. You're going to have a problem. But I have overcome that problem. You lean on me, you come to me, and we will get through this problem. Okay, moving on, verses 2 and 3. It says, the people quarreled with Moses, and they grumbled with Moses, and they were badgering Moses. They were taking it out on Moses. And how many times in my life, in your life, have you taken it out on someone Or let's just use me and my wife as an example. Okay, so my wife and I don't exactly agree on a situation. Okay, so there's two ways we can do it. I can attack her, she can attack me. I can attack her, she can attack me. And guess what? When you throw mud, you lose ground. However, we can take it vertically. We can take it vertically, okay? And I'm gonna look at the problem through his eyes. She's gonna look at the problem through her eyes. And you know what's amazing? As we look to him for our answer, we not only draw closer to him, we also draw closer to each other. Ephesians 4:29, it says this: let no corrupt talk come out of your mouths, but only such as is good for building up, as fits the occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear. Here in Exodus, they're answering Moses. They're answering Moses through an emotional response versus a godly response. They're battling the problem horizontally. They're battling the problem horizontally. They're not taking it vertically. If you take it vertically, you come up to scripture like Matthew 11:28-30, and it says this. Jesus says this: come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. When we invite God into our situations, when we go to him for his advice, when we go to him for what do we do in this situation, what do we do? When we go to him, it greatly helps the outcome. Philippians 4:6-7, it says this: do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Notice in verse 4 what Moses does. So Moses cried to the Lord, and he said, what shall I do with this people? Moses takes it upward. He takes it all upward. This is a godly response. Moses says, Lord, what shall I do? It's always best when we get raw and real with him. Don't try and handle it on your own. Whenever I try and handle it all on my own, in my own strength, in my own power, it never ends well. It just doesn't. My wife used to work in a office environment. I called it the cube world. And that's why I titled today's sermon, 4-8 That. 4-8 That. So my wife bought this little plaque by Marvel Comics. It's the superhero Captain America. But this was her way of keeping her sanity at her place of work, because there was a lot of political stuff going around. There was a lot of badgering going around. And so what she did, in order how to share the gospel in one of those worlds where you're not allowed to share the gospel, so she bought this plaque, and then she wrote 4-8 That. And so what she would do is she would just set it on her cube like that. People would go past. What in the world is 4-8 That? And it's Philippians 4:8, the verse that we had read. It says, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there's any excellence, if there's anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Think about the things that are on the positive side of life. Okay. Yes, right now it is tough. Right now it is bad. There's no denying it. What did Jesus say? You will have tribulation. Yes, you will. Yes, you will have speed bumps. But look on the other side of the coin. There is another side of the coin. Okay, so let's go where they are. Okay, they just saw the Egyptians have 10 plagues laid on them. They saw 10 plagues laid on them. They were freed from slavery. Now they're their own people. They go to the Red Sea. They're not crossing the Red Sea unless God performs a miracle, and he does. They cross on dry land. They cross on dry land. They get to the other side. They look behind them, and there are 600 choice chariots, along with men, chasing them across the sea. They get to see the wheels fall off the chariots. They get to see the wheels fall off the chariots. They get to see the water come back on them. They get to see all of them floating. All of their enemies are no longer there. They have a pillar of fire by night. They have a pillar of cloud by day. They have manna that's coming to them supernaturally every single day. Again, going to what is true in their life right now. What is true? What is worthy of praise? You remember, just 2 weeks ago, Elder Tom shared about the bitter water made sweet. You and I will see a miracle or two in our lives. We will, okay? And now, if miracles happened every day, they wouldn't be called miracles. But anyway, we will see things in our life that we know had to be the hand of God on it. So think about those things. Go back to those things. In my case, write them down. Write them down, because there will be times where you get kicked in the proverbial stomach, the spiritual stomach, because it's like you said, you're not going to have a good day every day. It's just not going to happen. So where do you go? Where do you go back to? Go back to what is true. What is worthy of praise? What is worthy of praise? Wayne Grudem says this: we individually and corporately reflect God's beauty in every way in which we exhibit his character. When we reflect his character, he delights in us and finds us beautiful in his sight. When we reflect his character, when we are that salt and that light that he has called us to be in our workplace, in our families, in our wherever it is, we reflect his beauty. There are two verses that go side by side in my mind. The first one is Matthew 6:33, it says, "But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you." Seek him first. Seek him first. My prayer for today is Colossians 3:2. Set my mind. Set your mind on things that are above, not on things in this earth. The earth changes. He never does. He never does. Now, there will be times in your life where you're going to come across something that you have no idea how to even fix it, how to even handle it. And that's where I use passages of Scripture as my prayer back to him. James 1:5 is my number one passage of Scripture that I go to. And let me show you what I do here. So James 1:5, it says, "If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given to him." So, Lord, this isn't my time that I'm using here. It's your time. I don't want to waste your time, Lord. So, Lord, if you don't want me to be involved in that, then show me. Lord, this isn't my money that I'm using here. Everything that comes to me came through your hands first. So I know that you provide me the money to do whatever it is that I need to do. So Lord, I don't want to invest your money in something that's not worth it. Is this a want or is this a need? Lord, whatever, Lord, all I can tell you, Lord, is at the end of the day, I want to hear these two words at the end of my day. Well done. So Lord, I need your wisdom, I need your guidance, I need your show me, Lord. Now, in my case, I will tell you, in my case, I will add this. Maybe you don't have to add this, but I will add this to my prayer. I am a hard-headed, thick-headed man. Okay, so what you need to do, Lord, is you need to make that wall solid. Make it solid, because it's the only way I get things. I don't know why it is, but it's a pattern in my life. The wall has to be really thick and really hard. Maybe you don't need to add that in your prayer, but I do. Okay. Psalm 25, 4 and 5. It says this. Make me know your ways, Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me. I want to go to the number one source that always has the right answer. I that's just what I want to do. I want to please him in my all. I'm not there yet, but we're working on it. Or I should say he's working on it. So anyway, verse 5. It says, and the Lord said to Moses, pass on before the people, taking with you some of the elders of Israel, and take in your hand the staff in which you struck the Nile, and go. Right out of the gate, just by reading that passage of Scripture, God reaffirms with Moses that you are the leader, Moses. I picked you. Yep, you got a bunch of naysayers. You're leading a bunch of naysayers, but I picked you. I picked you, and you will lead them. Now, here is something that is incredibly critical in this passage of Scripture. It says, take with you some of the elders of Israel. Oh, my, my. If there is one thing that in the military, whenever they wanted you to pass a test and they gave you some information that you needed to know, because if you don't know this information, you're not passing the test. They called it a foot stomper. Here's a foot stomper, okay? Take with you some of the elders. Never, ever, 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 ever go alone in your Christian walk. When you and I get alone by ourselves in our own mentality, and we do things by ourselves in our own little hole, in our own little way, in our own, it never ends well. Never ends well. Don't go it alone. I'm telling you, when I get alone by my thoughts, by my, I just go down and down and down and down and down. Never go it alone. Hebrews 10, 24, 25, it says, and let us consider one another, consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together as is in the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. So most of you know, my family's situation, our health situation of years past. And yes, there were times where we needed to watch the church service, if you will, virtually, where we needed to. But I firmly believe that there are some people right now, okay, who choose to stay home and not be with the one another's. I think I would look at that scripture a little bit harder. It says, do not neglect to meet with the one another's. I get it. There are some watching online. I know who you are, okay? And you truly have a medical situation. I get that. do not neglect to meet with the one another's. Now, he says, take your staff. Take your staff. Now, the staff is just an ordinary piece of wood. The ordinary piece of wood. And God can, you know, what do they say? God can hit a bullseye with a crooked stick. Well, it's just a piece of wood. But Moses has used that with the power of God's word through that stick to change things. Remember when he struck the Nile and it turned? Okay. Remember when he turned touched the Red Sea and it turned? So this is just the word of God changing things. Hebrews 4:12. And it says this. It says, for the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and spirit, of joints and marrow, and discerning the thoughts and the intentions of the heart. The word of God is incredibly, incredibly powerful. Don't neglect to bring God's word into your situation. Verse 6, he says, behold, this is God talking to Moses. He says, behold, I will stand before you on the rock at Horeb, and you shall strike the rock, and water shall come out of it, and the people will drink. And Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. Chuck Swindoll says this. He says, we are all faced with a series of great opportunities, brilliantly disguised as impossible situations. And you know what? They are impossible situations. Always keep God in your equation. When you keep God in your equation, okay, when we invite him into our problem, when we invite him into our situation, it changes everything. God performs another miracle. He promises. God promises. God delivers. James 4:8-10. It says, draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will exalt you. Many years back, we had a gentleman, Richard Thomas, that was in our men's study group. And so what would happen is, over time, men would come into the study group, and they'd be gone for several, might be years, and then they'd come back, and they'd come back a total train wreck. And I always liked what Richard Thomas would say to them. Oh, listen, kid, God didn't go anywhere. You did. And it's true. It's true. It says that when we draw near to God, he'll draw near to you. My distance from God is dependent on me. When I get too busy, when I get too carried away, when I get mired in someone else's ick, okay, I pull myself away from hearing what he has to say to me. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. It's incredibly important that we have a time set aside. I remember when I heard this many years back that, you know, you should really have a daily quiet time. You should really have a daily quiet time. I thought, oh my goodness, you know, some of these people are doing it for like 45 minutes a day. I don't have that kind of a time. Yes, you do. Do you drive? Is it possible that you could be listening while driving? For example, Mondays I cut grass. It's very possible that I can listen to podcasts while cutting grass. You can too. Okay? I'm not saying that you need 45 minutes a day, but I'm just saying start somewhere, start small, but by all means start. By all means start. Verse 7. And he called the name of the place Massah and Meribah because of the quarreling of the people of Israel, and because they tested the Lord by saying, is the Lord among us or not? So it's amazing how God places names on things. if you look throughout Scripture, God will always name a situation, especially one like this, where they're testing the Lord. So, here's something. It's okay to ask God questions. Matter of fact, I know that God delights greatly in us asking Him questions. What do you want me to do here? How do you want me to handle this? Which way should I go? What do you want me to do? God delights in questions, but it's not okay to question God. In other words, when I question God, I put myself on His level, or I put myself even above His level. It's okay to ask God questions. It's not okay to question God. Do you see the difference? Psalm 95, verse 7 and 8. For He is our God, and we are the people of His pasture, and the sheep of His hand. Today, if you hear His voice, do not harden your hearts as at Meribah, or as on the day at Massa in the wilderness. When we hear from Him, and oh, by the way, when we hear from Him, more than likely it's not going to sound right. By that I mean that's not the way you would handle that situation. It's going to be totally different. It's going to look totally different. You no way would you ever answer it that way. No way would you ever go that road. But it's going to be different. That's a good indication that you're on the correct track, because it doesn't make sense to you. That's okay. Hebrews 3, 7 and 8, it says, therefore, as the Holy Spirit says, today, if you hear His voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion on the day of the wilderness. So here's my question to you. What's your wilderness? What wilderness are you going through? This sermon today, how myself, my wife, Julie, came up with Philippians 4:8. Way back, I should have asked Tom or Debbie, but way back, Elder Tom was in the hospital battling cancer. And life wasn't good for either of them. And they came across this passage of Scripture, and I remember how this passage of Scripture greatly, greatly helped not only them, but us to see that there is a bigger picture. There is a better tomorrow. There is something to look forward to. Look at where He is, not where you are. Many a year ago, I came across this saying, and I say it every now and again to myself, and it's this. Don't tell God how big your storm is. Tell the storm how big your God is. Okay? Just remember who you serve. Remember who's got you. Who's got you? Isaiah 43, 18 and 19. It says, remember not the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? And I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. Moses, I'm sure, when he heard that I'm supposed to strike a rock and water comes out of it? Okay. But Moses did what God told him to do. And we will come up, you know the saying, well, he's between a rock and a hard place? Gee, I wonder where that came from. But anyway, so when we come up and we're between a rock and a hard place, the hard place is not that hard of a place. So hard is hard. It's not impossible. It's just hard. What's your wilderness? So, here's my question for you. Are you taking it, are you taking your problem horizontally? Are you taking it horizontally, or are you taking it vertically? Are you taking it vertically? Vertically, obviously, is the best answer. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for your word. I thank you for the power that is in your word. I thank you for the power that's within you. Lord, just help us in our day, Lord, to see you, to seek you, to always ask you into our equation. Lord, as we launch out into our week, starting up here, Lord, I just pray, Lord, that we just put you in the center of it all. Lord, I thank you for, this opportunity that you've given me, Lord, to just be up here to serve you and hopefully serve you well. We love you, Lord. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.